In our next two videos, we're going to look at Bootstrap's final library of components, the JavaScript components. But before we do that, let's talk briefly about the concept of progressive enhancement. Progressive enhancement is a strategy for building websites and applications where we focus on the core content and experience before layering on any additional content and functionality. The purpose of this is to ensure that our websites and apps always work for as many people as possible across as many different devices as possible. And we've actually been following this strategy pretty closely by building our Whiskey Drop landing page. Firstly, with regard to our HTML, we started by creating our content and enforcing good mobile-first design. We've also taken care to write clean, semantic HTML throughout the process. This allows search engines and screen readers or other accessibility devices to access our content. Secondly, regarding our CSS, we've relied on Bootstrap so far to provide us with 100% of our styling. This means that our styles are consistent and our site makes sense visually. Most importantly, it's responsive across all devices. So only now, with our landing page functioning perfectly, which is just basic HTML and CSS, do we consider adding any advanced functionality with JavaScript. By maintaining this pyramid of functionality, we guarantee that anyone who arrives at our landing page, regardless of their device, will be able to experience our content. So with this concept of progressive enhancement in mind, we can look at the final library of components that Bootstrap offers, which is JavaScript. This is how our site will look when we've finished this section. We'll have an additional drop-down visible in desktop mode, and when viewed on a mobile, the navbar will collapse down into a handy button and save space on the smaller screen. It's worth pointing out at this stage as well that you don't need to know any JavaScript to be able to add these components in. That's outside the scope of this lesson. For your milestone project, you'll be required to create a static HTML and CSS site. But you can and should use some of these JavaScript components that Bootstrap provides, because no knowledge of JavaScript is required in order to use them. With all of this in mind then, let's go back to our Bootstrap page and see how to integrate JavaScript into our project. We need to click on the download button and then scroll down to the CDNs. And we're just going to click on copy on the first set of links here, and then go back and paste them into our project. This time we're going to paste them right down at the end of the body. I'll explain why in just a moment. We can see though that this is also including Bootstrap's CSS again. We can delete that since we already have that loading at the top of our HTML file. You'll notice though on the download page that a couple of other JavaScript libraries are needed in order to use Bootstrap's JavaScript. So we'll copy the links for those and paste them in before Bootstrap's JavaScript. Now that they're in, let's just make sure that they're working by clicking on the Network tab in our Developer Tools, the JS pane, and then reloading our page. We can see there that all of our files are loading with the status of 200, which means OK, they've loaded properly. So why did I include my files at the bottom of the page, but the CSS files at the top? Well, remember that when the browser opens our website, it interprets HTML from top to bottom. So we want the CSS to be loaded as quickly as possible, so the user doesn't see an unstyled page. So for that reason, we place the CSS files at the top. Conversely, we don't want to prevent the user from seeing the content by including any large JavaScript files that might hold up the process. So for that reason, we place our JavaScript files at the bottom of the page, so they're only processed once all of the HTML and CSS has been loaded by the browser. Now that we have our Bootstrap JavaScript library loaded, let's include some new components. As we can see on our mobile site here, the menu is taking up quite a lot of real estate on the screen. So we're going to add in functionality to compress that to a button. Firstly, I'm going to paste in the code, and then we can talk through it and see what's happening. So we're adding a new button and giving that the class of navbar toggler. We're also giving it ML Auto, which will push it over to the right. We have some strange attributes here marked Data Toggle and Data Target. The Data Toggle attribute is telling Bootstrap that this button will be used as a trigger for a collapsible element somewhere on the page. The Data Target gives the ID of the collapsible element. We'll create that in a minute. ARIA stands for Accessible Rich Internet Applications, and these attributes are used to provide accessibility to screen readers. They provide these devices with extra context of the purpose of a particular element on the page. It's outside the scope of this lesson to discuss what they mean, but it's an interesting subject to Google if you have time. Inside our button, we also have a span, which has the class of navbar toggler icon. And this will provide the three-bar icon for our button. Now then, we can create a div with the navbar nav dropdown ID. And this will be the collapsible element. So we need to give it the class of collapse and navbar collapse. And then the ID of navbar nav dropdown, which will match the ID in our button. I'll take the div and put the closing div tag down underneath our unordered list, and just beautify our code so it looks better. As you can see, the ID navbar nav dropdown matches the ID in data target. This is so that Bootstrap knows what the target of the button is. Let's refresh our page now and see what happens in mobile. As we can see, our menu now compresses down to this handy button. When I click on the button, the menu expands, and when I click on it again, it toggles back to its collapsed state. So this is very useful. It's taking up much less real estate on the screen. Let's add some more functionality to our navbar. And what we're going to do is add a dropdown. So before the sign-in sign-up link, we're going to create a new list item. Again, this will have the class of navitem, and also the class of dropdown. Again, I'm going to paste in the code here that provides our dropdown functionality. This is a link this time. It has the class of navlink, so it'll be styled the same as the other links in our navbar, but it has the class of dropdown toggle. It also has the ID of navbar dropdown menu link. And its data toggle this time is that it's looking for a drop-down element to toggle. We need to put our drop-down element inside the list item. And what we're going to do is supply a list of different kinds of whiskies that our Whiskey Drop website provides. So I'll paste in that div, beautify the code. So our div has the class of drop-down menu. We also have the ARIA attribute to give extra information for accessible devices. When we refresh our page now, we can see on the mobile view that we have this new dropdown with Irish, Scotch, Japanese, and American whiskies. When I return to the desktop, we have this convenient dropdown here, which also gives the same whiskies as well. So this is very useful, to be able to add this kind of functionality to a navbar and to have it collapse down to a button. All of this code came from the Bootstrap documentation on navbars, so don't be afraid to copy and paste this code into your own projects. Be careful of copying and pasting code from unknown sources, though. Only copy and paste it in if you know what the code is going to do. You can trust the code in the Bootstrap documentation, though. So that concludes our first video on adding JavaScript components into our Whiskey Drop landing page. In our next video, we'll add one more JavaScript component, the modal, which is a pop-up dialog box, which will further enhance the user experience.